Viewer discretion is advised. I do not claim ownership to any of the following copyrighted material featured in this video.
Who's the guy who stops cinemas, lots of plans, once and for all? Me. This guy. Ha ha. Damn, I'm good. Master, I bring very bad news to you. Come on, Icarus, could you at least do something useful for once and actually carry these damn groceries for me? But Master, Cinema's Lot, his new video is up.
Well, Yugi, it looks like we've come to this state. If we don't initiate this three-step plan now, the future could be a dire and desperate one. I sure wish there was more that we could do other than this. All that matters is that we face the future together. And I wouldn't have it any other way. Are you ready, partner? Ready! Sorry that this phone call is incredibly late, Kagami, but step one of our three-step plan has finally been put into motion. It's only a matter of time now before everything goes back to normal.
That's a relief.
So do you think you'll have everything covered by then?
Sure. I'm sure we'll have everything covered by then. And I'm just glad that things are going back to normal.
Chances on the game you're playing. Oh, you know you found the one you really need. Cause it only comes down once in a lifetime. Only comes round once in a lifetime.
Hey guys, and welcome back once again to the Cinema's Lot Movie and Anime Review Show! And in celebration of the long-awaited return to this show on Cinema's Lot, I have decided to go back and rewatch one of my all-time favorite animes of all time. And also, I figured this would also be a relatively cool occasion to finally touch on something that I feel like I've been wanting to do a review on for a very, very, very long time. And I'll just go ahead and get this out of the gate so that way you guys are aware of this. This was the anime that rejoiced my interest in anime at a very young age. Because when I was growing up in middle school, I kind of lost my interest in anime for a little bit. I don't know what it was, but I feel like it was more or less that I never really got to experience that many, because around the time that I was gradually getting out of the age where I would be watching cartoons all the time, Toonami was canned for a while, and the only animes that would come on TV would be like Naruto or One Piece, and I mean, I liked the early Naruto stuff, but I'm not a big One Piece fan whatsoever, and once it became way, way too difficult to keep up with animes like Bleach or Inuyasha and everything, even though I enjoyed those back in the day, it was still so hard to keep up with them that, and of course the DVD and Blu-ray box sets at the time were so expensive, and they still are nowadays, but I kind of just lost my interest in watching anime for a while, you know? I felt like I saw what I needed to see and everything, and I thought, you know, I kind of grew out of it, you know? But one day, I walk into an FYE store when we still had those, and I just, you know, okay, I'm just gonna walk through the anime section, you know, maybe give it a look. I see a DVD in there with a very weird cover on it, so I decided to take a look at it, look at the back, and read what it was about and everything, and there was this tagline for it called Boobies for the Win. Now, knowing that I saw this DVD case at a young age, around 8th grade, you could imagine the immediate reaction I thought was, what the heck is this, and what do I need to do to watch it? Basically, right? I remember laughing so hard because it seemed like the worst piece of junk that you could ever ask for in anime form, but I didn't buy it because, you know, $50 for a 12-episode anime. I'm like, that's outrageous! But then, a couple of months later, me and a buddy of mine are doing, like, you know, like a little sleepover and that sort of stuff, you know, where we're, you know, we're hanging out, playing some games, you know, and all that good stuff. And then, all of a sudden, we decide, you know what, why don't we watch something on Netflix? We go on Netflix, and we see it on Netflix, and we're like, we are watching this. So, me and my friend watched the entire first season on Netflix many years ago while I was in eighth grade. And I remember thinking, like, I was completely baffled by what I was watching, but I was also, like, surprised that I didn't, like, hate it or absolutely love it so much at the time. And then, progressively, I got to watch other anime, and I started to become more and more interested in anime all over again, and I owe it to this anime for that. Plus, after I went and delved into the realms of Rosary Vampire, Heaven's Lost Property, Girls Bravo, and a bunch of other awful animes, I looked back at this one, I'm like, you know what? That one wasn't that bad, actually. In fact, let's rewatch it. Wow, that I don't remember it being that good. Wow, I really do enjoy this. And that's what I'm here to talk to you about today, guys. I'm here to talk to you about one of the animes that is the most important to me. Because in the history of my life, there are a few animes that really stick out and have had a huge impact on me at some point or another. Whether it be Yu-Gi-Oh!, Inuyasha, Bleach, and then finally, Sekirei. And now, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, let's not waste any time and let's finally get into the review that has quite literally been nearly a decade in the making for you guys. So let's delve in right now.
The premise of Sekirei is pretty simple. It follows our main protagonist, Minato Sahashi, who after failing his college entrance exam for the second time, ends up running into a beautiful young girl named Musubi, who happens to be a Sekirei, or an alien species that has superhuman and natural abilities and powers that are used for the purpose of fighting and protecting others. And from there, they are ultimately teamed up into a partnership for a game run by the president of MBI named Hiruto Minaka, who pretty much turns the entire city into a full-fledged battlefield. And from there, Minato learns more and more about the Sekirei, who Musubi, of course, is, and the Ashikabi, who is the partner of a Sekirei and the person that a Sekirei is most destined to serve and protect all throughout their lives, who he happens to be. And they run into other characters, and ultimately Minato creates a brand new harem for himself, which of the list includes Ku, a young girl who works with plants, and also calls Minato his big ol' bro, Matsu, a major computer hacker and specialist, Tsukumi, a water type, Kazehana, a drunk wind user, and finally Homura, a masked vigilante fire user. And of course, Minato and every other Ashikabi in the city are ultimately fighting for a grand prize that is awarded to the last Ashikabi and or Sekireis with them left standing. Now, I know this all seems very familiar to you guys when it comes to the bare gist of the plot, but that's because, yeah, we have seen this kind of story done many times in the past. But what matters in this case is that it tries to still tell the story well and gives us fun characters and good reasons to watch this said harem anime other than just for straight up comedy the entire time. Which ultimately leads me into what it is that makes me love this show very much. The characters featured here are tons of fun, and the story is ever flowing and always progressing. Yes, there is tons of comedy and quote-unquote breast humor to behold here, but at the same time, the main focus of Sekirei is, surprisingly enough, the story and the characters. And the majority of characters that are given here are given good screen time and are even given good reason for you to even care about what's going on. And for me, that's ultimately what the most important part of watching a movie or anime is. Does it get me invested? And on top of all that, am I able to enjoy it all the way through to the very end? The way the show balances its blend of humor and story is very well handled. It never feels like the humor takes over the course of the show, and there is plenty of story to go around, especially when you get to the second season of the show, where most of the backstory starts to take center stage. And while yes, there is tons of breast humor to be found here.
Alright, Musubi, promise me we'll take a bath together next time. K. okay.
What the?
I guess that means you haven't had the chance to touch these babies yet, have you?
No, of course I haven't.
There is also tons of comedy that is funnier in other ways and shape and form. There is also tons of action to keep everything going and progressing and keep things entertaining. Even if, yeah, the action for the most part is not the most mesmerizing thing in the whole world. Don't expect anything Sword Art Online quality in terms of action, but it's good enough that you'll will definitely not get bored as you're watching it. Plus, there are a few fights that do go on throughout the show that are actually a lot better than the rest. I don't know why that is, but let's just say some of the more dramatic moments in the show is when the action starts to get a little bit more interesting. Maybe it's because of what's going on with the characters at that particular time, or maybe it's because the action gets a little bit more intense for what it is. But either way, there are a couple of standout fights throughout the show that do stick out in my mind.
Now, of course, now that we're getting up to this very particular point in the review, I feel like there's something I need to address that is very key and important to lay in with you guys. What I feel makes an anime really work for me personally, or is something that will get me more hooked and interested in an anime, is of course the characters, or more specifically, the main protagonist. If the main protagonist is not that interesting, not that likable, or is someone I can't relate to, or is just a character I just don't feel anything for, a lot of my enjoyment for the particular anime is going to go down very quickly. And there's been many anime that I've watched in which I feel nothing for the main character, or I feel very, like, hatred-filled feelings towards that I just stop caring about what's going on, and when nothing else is working and everything, then the whole thing comes down to the ground. Even if there's other interesting things going on, I feel like I'm not going to be able to enjoy a particular anime as much as, like, somebody else would. Now, with this one, on the other hand, the main character of this particular anime, I feel, is actually, much like the anime itself, one of the most underrated characters or main protagonist characters in anime, at least in my opinion.
Now, I am not saying that he is the most perfect individual known to mankind or anything, and I am also not going to act like this guy has no flaws in him whatsoever, because he does. But unlike other protagonists in ecchi/harem animes where they don't seem to grow as characters over time, which is what all protagonists are supposed to do, otherwise they don't have a character arc to them, and unlike other characters where they just do so many disrespectful and just awful things during the course of the show and have no redeeming qualities in them whatsoever, Minato is not like that. He's actually a naturally flawed but still caring person all at the same time. He has his urges like any growing male would experience in his lifetime, but he still tries to act like an adult when he is being brought into dangerous territory. And while he clearly can't stand a chance against the Sekirei he comes in contact with, he actually does stand up for what he believes in as the show progresses, and shows that he has grown naturally since the very first episode in which he was kind of a wimp. And even from the first episode, we see that there's still something hidden inside of him that actually can grow out at some point in time, showing his true character and personality.
Now, just because I'm giving this show loads of praise all the way to the 10th degree, that doesn't mean I don't have any problems with it whatsoever. In fact, I actually have a couple of criticisms with it, and I tried to be objective as possible with this, considering how this is one of my favorite animes of all time. One of the immediate things that comes up to me is that, yes, the amount of breast humor in this particular show is enough to turn some people off. So if you can't handle that whatsoever, you're not going to enjoy this anime, because it is, that kind of humor is spread out thoroughly throughout the show. Now, granted, I don't think it's as bad as, let's say, other animes have done in the past or in the present by any means. And again, the story is there enough to where you can get behind it and you can look past, you know, the breast jokes and all that stuff and still be able to enjoy the story. Now, but I understand that some people are not going to be all up in the air, let's say, about this anime if that kind of humor is in there. So that is kind of a problem. Now, on a more, even more objective level, I guess you could say, is, well, it's not, I don't know if I could really call it objective at this point, because I'm comparing it to its original source material. And being that this is an anime based on an original manga, there's going to be tons of differences. And there are quite a few differences I've noticed because the manga's completed, so the entire storyline of Sekirei is in the manga. So if you want to know the whole gist of the storyline, you have to read the manga for that, pretty obviously. But I'm not one of those guys that will say, oh, the manga or the book is always better, the anime is or movies are always shit by comparison. I'm not like that whatsoever. In this case, though, I will agree and comply that the manga is definitely better. But here's the thing. It's only because there's more to see, there's more story, there's even more action even, and also on top of all that, they explain a lot in the manga. There's so much in the manga that's not explored or even explained in the anime whatsoever, which does ultimately lead to the second season leaving it with so many plot holes and loose ends. Well, maybe not necessarily plot holes, but just a couple of loose ends that could have been tied up or answered, you know. And the thing is that I understand that the tsunamis of the early 2000s that hit Japan back in the day definitely halted the production of a third season for both Sekirei and Rosary Vampire. I am aware of that because being that I was hooked on news for any sort of buzz for a third season of this show for years, and now I've you know, fully come to the realization that that's not going to happen, unfortunately. And even with that said, they've still made some significant changes that really do affect like how the story progresses with both the anime and the manga. Because in the manga, let's just say a particular huge, huge important event happens that doesn't happen until way, way later in the manga, but yet it actually appeared in the anime before it appeared in the manga. So if you're one of those people that gets really, really, you know, just anal about that sort of stuff, that will be a big issue with you. And also, the ending to the second season is, you know, for the most part, not in the manga either. Now, here's the thing. It doesn't bother me as much as it would someone else, of course, because I feel like what we're still given here is still well made, still well put together, and in the case of all the English dub voice actors and everything, it's actually well acted too, so I'm willing to get past that and still appreciate it for what it is, you know? Though that's still something I do have a problem with, especially when season 2 ends on a huge cliffhanger. Such a huge cliffhanger that it really pains me that there's not a third season to this series whatsoever, or even a movie for that matter, that could have wrapped everything up. Because even though I would have preferred a third season, I think I would have been fine and down for, let's say, a movie that kind of wrapped up all the last bits of the story that were still missing in the anime and that wasn't told from the manga yet, you know? But, again, if you're not one of those people who really cares about that sort of stuff or you don't really read manga at all, it ain't really gonna bug you that much other than the cliffhanger at the end of season 2. So, yeah, basically my main problem with the show, or the anime, I should say, is that it just lacks some missed potential, you know? It really does lack some potential towards the end. Because as it's going and as it's building, it's doing really well and it gets you hooked into it right immediately. And with what's given, it's pretty good, but it could have been even more. And that's my major, major complaint with the show, is that there could have been more. There was more that could have been done with it, but they weren't able to do it, which is very disappointing. But at the end of the day, we still have the manga, in case you want to know more about the story. And for what it's worth, I'm glad that it didn't that the anime didn't overstay its welcome, because that's something I really gained from watching this anime for the first time, going back to it several times over the years, and after and getting to experience several other animes over the past like many, many years since I've been out of middle school, whether it be Cowboy Bebop or Angel Beats or Ryuni Kenshin, it doesn't matter. I've gotten to experience loads of different kinds of animes, and most of them happen to be 12 to 26 episodes long. And to be honest, I think I kind of prefer it like that. Now, granted, depending on the series, I may want it to go a little longer than that, you know? And to be fair, with Bleach, I feel like they were perfectly fine up until after the third season, but that's just my opinion, of course. So this anime did teach me a lot of things and broadened my interest in anime to other areas and allowed me to see, oh yeah, animes are not always just like 500 episodes long or anything and are impossible to get into by this point. No, they can be almost like one singular movie in which you watch it, you get the experience, and you live with it, and you gained a new experience, and you didn't have to sit there for like 500 hours watching a television series, you know? It's in a similar boundary, I feel like, in that sense, you know? And lastly, I want to add in that the English dub for this particular anime is one of the best English dubs that I've ever heard in my life. Now, English dubs, I understand, can be a little iffy depending on which anime you watch, and I understand sometimes, you know, there's like some issues that go into account when people do the translations, or because they obviously always do changes, you know, no matter what anime tries to get it 100% correctly, they are always going to make some changes. When it comes to English dubs, I usually look at a couple of animes that I look at as like the standards. A few of them will be like Princess Mononoke, Spirited Away, Akira, both versions. I love both. I really do enjoy both of the dubs for that one. And Sekirei, really. In all honesty, like, that's one of the best dubs I've ever listened to in my life. And it actually has a huge all-star cast with it, too, including people like Joel McDonald, Alexis Tippin, Colin Klinkenbeard, Lee Clark, Todd Hapricorn, you name it. There's a lot of big names on this thing. And it makes you wonder, especially when the advertising for this show was so different overseas compared to here. Because overseas, like the second season, let's say, for example, was advertised as a big action anime, you know, with a lot of like story going on, you know, and there is a lot of that in there. And then over here, it's just like, oh, yeah, boobies for the win. Yeah, that'll totally bring in everyone. Yeah, let's bring it. Let's just advertise. That's the only thing in the show. So, it makes you wonder why this wasn't a bigger deal in Japan or anything like that, even. Because in the States, yeah, okay, it didn't really do that well. I kind of get that. But overseas, I don't get why this didn't, like, become, like, you know, I mean, I understand why it never became, like, Sword Art Online or anything like that in terms of popularity. But I still don't get why it didn't get the same traction that other animes do. I don't know, but at the end of the day, though, I really feel like this is an anime I recommend you guys watching in English dub, because I feel like the English dub is well worth it. There's not a single character in this particular anime that I feel like is miscasted with its English dub. And that is a miraculous achievement, and I love you guys for that. And I think that means now, guys, we have come to the final verdict for this particular anime review. And I was a little torn on this one, actually, because even though this is one of my all-time favorite animes, I honestly wanted to give it a slightly lower rating than what I was initially going to give it. Because my original rating for this was going to be a 4 out of 4, but once I thought about some of the lacked potential towards the end, and the fact that it does change a couple of things in big ways towards the latter half of the second season from the manga, it kind of brought it down a few small points for me. You know, and that's me being completely objective, guys, you know. So, I'll go ahead and give you two ratings, you know, for what it's done for me as an anime fan and as someone who needed something to really get them back on the train of watching anime again, you know. And because I still enjoy this anime even to this very day, I'm going to give it my all-star approval rating of a 4 out of 4 with a CinemaZlot seal of approval. But if I'm going to go 100% objective with all the flaws and everything put into full effect here, I'm going to give it a 3.5 out of 4, meaning it's still well worth checking out, guys, and you don't want to miss out on it. It's one of the most underrated animes in the past 10 years as far as I'm concerned, and if you guys haven't seen it, I recommend giving it a shot. It's available on most of your typical anime viewing websites, whether it be Crunchyroll or Netflix. And I'm pretty sure that at this point in time, Netflix does have both seasons of Sekirei on there. Now, don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure that that's the case, you know? Now, with that, guys, I will end it here. Thank you once again for joining me for the return of CinemaZlot's Movie and Anime Review Show. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, leave a comment and tell me what your thoughts are on Sekirei, because you can tell I'm a big fan of it, you know, if this shirt definitely didn't give it away. Tsukumi's awesome, by the way. But I want to know what you guys think in the comments below, and I want to know where it ranks among your favorite animes, or even least favorite if you think that I'm, like, talking out of my ass the whole review. I want to know in the comments below. Let me know, guys. And finally, guys, thank you once again for watching, and I will see you guys in the next review. See you guys soon.